أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا وطبيب نفوسنا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم لا سيما بقية الله روحی و ارواح العالمین لتراب مقدمه الفدا. Brothers and sisters in Islam, السلام علیکم جمیعا و رحمت الله و برکاته. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our fasting, our worshipping. We have the Layal al-Qadr behind us, inshallah, hoping and feeling that our sins are forgiven, and may God bless us to be able to maintain, inshallah, what we have gained in the last nights and all the way through. Inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, due to His infinite mercy, has written for us to be good, practicing, pious Muslims, Shia followers of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam, not only in the year to come, all the way to the end of our life. Every night that I prepare something to share with you, subhanAllah, suggestions come, and I respect those suggestions, and I, especially when more than one person gives a suggestion, I consider it more seriously that perhaps that's a topic that we need to share with. And that's why tonight also the topic is based on the feedback and the suggestion. And please, with all respect, don't give any more suggestions, because already I have so many suggestions to fulfill, and I'm here with you maximum one more week. And most of the topics that I had in mind, still I haven't touched it. I've been sacrificing my preference over your preference, because I respect that you're living here and you understand the needs, the local needs, obviously more than myself. And as Haj Riaz mentioned, this trip is more of a commercial. And if I'm jumping from one topic to another, forgive me for that. The topic for tonight, as simple as it is and as logical as it is, unfortunately in today's world, Islam and the path of Ahlul Bayt, which is the true path of Islam, has been bombarded and has been the target of various malicious defamation, causing doubts. And all of these are mainly because, unfortunately, our knowledge about our religion is rather more inherited, shallow, and not in-depth. We don't have in-depth study about our religion. That's why anyone comes with any misgiving, all of a sudden it's shaken in my belief system. The topic tonight is about, why is it that I have to follow a mujtahid? Why is it that in our faith we have marja'iyyah taqleed? Am I not supposed to practice Islam based on my own research? Why someone decides for me how I pray, how I fast, and the rest of my religious duties and what I have to do? The answer to this is that when it comes to principles of religion, usul al-din, yes, there is no following, no one is allowed to follow anyone else. Because at least for the basics of the principles of religion, that why there is a creator and that there is one creator, belief in life after death, believing in the prophets and prophet of Islam and the imams, everyone is bound to do their research, no matter how little it is, so far as they are convinced that this universe has a creator. Not just because my dad was Muslim or told me that the God exists, I have to believe in God. Not because Ayatollah Sistani, Hafizahullah, for example, has said that there is a creator for this universe, I believe. I have to do my little research to the best of my ability. But when it comes to the details of the religion, to the practicality of my religion, it is not possible for every single person to do their research, for the reasons that inshallah tonight I want to share with you, and I hope the topic will be clear. And after that, still, if there was any questions or comment, by all means, I'm happy to stay behind and address your questions and listen to your comments. The issue of following a marja and choosing and having a marja is as common sense and as that easy of our day-to-day practice. When we get sick, naturally we go to a carpenter, correct? No, we go to a doctor. When we need a carpentry job done, we go to a carpenter. How come that when it comes to medicine and curing myself and my body, I don't say, why should I give my body to the hand of one doctor? He writes a prescription, and do you ever ask him that, sir, doctor, why is it that you are writing this antibiotic for me? Why is it that I have to take it three times a day, for example, every 6 hours, every 8 hours, not nine, ten? Why is it like this? Do you ever, when you go to the doctor, do you sit with him and tell him, can you please give me the medical explanation behind this? No, you trust your doctor, he writes your prescription, you take it to the chemist and take it, simple as this. Not even knowing for your life that what is inside this tablet, okay? You trust the experts. Likewise, your car breaks, you take it to a mechanic, you carpentry, plumbing. That's how we live our life, in all aspects of our life. Did you ask ever what is the reason, is there any hadith, any ayah that when I get sick I have to go to a doctor, I don't need to go to a plumber? Common sense dictates, isn't it? So the foundation, really, the bottom line reason for the issue of following a mujtahid also is the common sense. In as much as it is a common sense to follow people of expertise, also when it comes to my religion, when I'm not an expert, it's a common sense. We go to an expert, the one who has studied more about religion than me. I ask him and I trust his judgment on the issues that I need to ask. The ayat and the riwayat that we have, and inshallah I share with you some of them tonight, these are just backing up, supporting that common sense reason. Otherwise, in fact, we don't need any ayah or any hadith. Even hypothetically speaking, if there was no ayah in the Quran, no hadith to tell us that we have to go to a mujtahid, as a religious expert, our common sense would dictate that we have to go. As that's how we run our life in other aspects of it. Alright? Besides these, yes, we have our numbers of the ayat and the riwayat. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran says, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Ask people of remembrance. Dhikr is one of the names of the Holy Quran. Quran is the dhikr. Alright? People who أهل الذِّكْر and أهل Quran, people who know the Quran. And Quran is the constitution of Islam. You can say, ask experts in Islam in Quran, in kuntum la ta'alamun, if you don't know. I don't know how am I supposed, who told you, how on earth would I know that the morning prayer is 2 rak'at, Zuhr prayer is 4 rak'at, and so forth? Unless you learned it from your mujtahid, from an expert, isn't it? Otherwise, how do we know? The ayat in the Quran that we have related to jurisprudence, to practical laws of Islam. I can pick up an ayah here and give you right now from the top of my head at least 5 different interpretations, and for each and every one of them convince you that is the meaning of it, and inshallah you will be convinced and none of them will be correct. It's a very delicate job dealing with the ayat of the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for example, really I'm just picking up from the top of my head without any preparation. وَطَعَامُ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابِ حِلٌّ لَكُمْ وَطَعَامُكُمْ حِلٌّ لَهُمْ. The food of the people of the book is halal for you, and their food and your food is halal for them. Question, according to this ayah, therefore the food of Christians, who are at the kitab, at least Christians and the Jews, the food of Christians is halal for you. Ayah of Quran, Surah Al-Ma'idah. Can I go to the food store and those Christians who are selling food, buy it from them and eat it? If that is the case, then Ya Allah, what's the purpose of slaughtering and halal meat? Why is it that in one place in the Quran you tell us we have to eat halal meat, in another place in the Quran say that go and eat the food of Ahl Kitab? It's okay. Kushan, for example, the Jewish meat, is it halal for us to eat or is it not halal for us? The Quran says that it's halal. Is my understanding of the Quran correct? Aha. That's why it becomes a bit more technical. You need to go to Imam Ja'far Sadiq alayhi salam, who tells that the term ta'am, that today we translate it into food, Quran was revealed to the Prophet 1400 years ago. You appreciate that even in English we have terms, words that they have a meaning today. 200 years ago had a different meaning. 500 years ago had a different meaning. 30 years ago, a baby girl is born and her parents would call her gay, meaning happy. Gay in English dictionary, you open the dictionary, especially the older dictionary, gay means happy. So they call her like Shadi that we have. They call her gay. So 30 years ago, 40 years ago, before this rising of homosexuality, gay was a common girl name and meant happy. Today has a different meaning. I'm just giving you this as an example of the trend, the change of the words in centuries. In Arabic we have this as well. In Arabic we have, so the term ta'am, for example, 1400 years ago was an expression for grains, for beans, for, put it this way, for vegetarian food, not meat food. Alright? Quran, because at the time of the Prophet, when Muslims were reading this ayah, وَطَعَامُ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابِ, they would understand what ta'am means. Today that we think that in Arabic or in English we translate it, it becomes food. Say food means any food. Anything that you eat. Do you see? There are technicalities. And this is only the a technicality related to the terminology, let alone understanding of the word of the Quran, let alone when it comes to the riwayat that we have, for example, on one topic, when they want to examine a sheikh that he has reached the level of ijtihad or not, one of the, for example, tests on him, they give him the riwayat related to the timing of the salat. We have riwayat about what is the best time for salat al-dhuhr, salat al-fajr, salat al-asr. Because these riwayat sometimes they are contradictory, it's a very technical job for a scholar, for a very learned scholar who has reached the level of ijtihad, who can handle and he can make a reconciliation between these narrations to come with a conclusion about it. And still he may or may not be right. But in as much as a doctor, a specialist in his field, also he may make a mistake, but that's a professional mistake rather than just the mistake that the common people they do. Alright, so that's why to become a mujtahid, to become an expert, put it this way, some people for some reasons they become allergic with this term mujtahid, marja'iyyah, taqleed. I tell them we are talking about experts in religious studies, my friend. And definitely this is by far more difficult than becoming expert in physical field. Some riwayat that we have are said taqiyatan. Abu Basir says that I was sitting next to Imam Sadiq alayhi salam. Somebody walked in and asked the question, Imam gave him an answer. He left. Second person came, asked the same question, Imam gave him a different answer. He left. Third person came, asked the same question, Imam gave him a third answer, different answer. I was dumbfounded. I said, yeah, after he left, I said, Ya Ibn Rasulullah, what's going on here? One question, three different answers. And then the Imam told me which one was the real answer. The other two were said taqiyatan. Now these ahadiths are compiled in the books of hadith that we have. And we are not there to see the context of the hadith. Alright? It's a very delicate job. I don't want to delve into it, but I'm telling you that this is definitely a very difficult task. A mujtahid spends 50 years, 60 years of his life researching about Islam and all these things. And guess what is his production? In his 60s, 70s, he writes a small book, 200 something pages, known as Tawzih al-Masail, Risala Amaliyya. That's how tough it is. And even then, most of you familiar, even then you go to his Risala Amaliyya, how often he says, according to obligatory precaution, do this. You know what does it mean? It means that I spent 50 years of my life to find out what is the actual ruling in this. I have not come to a satisfactory answer to that. And therefore, because I don't want to put my neck, I don't want to take the responsibility on the Day of Judgment, I've taken the precaution side. Otherwise, when a mujtahid tells us obligatory precaution in a simple language for us, that we know the background of the story, it means I don't know. How many times our maraji they say obligatory precaution, yani I really don't know, I'm not 100% sure about this, but take the precaution. And now all of a sudden somebody comes, wants to become a mujtahid, marja, give fatwa. I think Islam says that, I think Allahu Akbar. In as much as I come up on a stage and I want to give some medical suggestions, a doctor laughs at me, Sheikh, please relax. We respect you, brother, but doesn't mean that if you have studied Islam, you know everything. It goes the other way around as well. Okay, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. When you don't know, go to those who know about the rules. This is in a nutshell about the wisdom behind ijtihad and why is it that we have to go to the marja. For the same reason, to go to the most learned one is also a common sense. If in the town there are 5 doctors available, one of them is more learned and more experienced than the other, which one do you go to? Common sense. 5 mechanics available, one of them is more experienced and more learned than the others. Which one do you go to? Do you need an ayah or hadith for me to tell you to which one to go to? No. The same when it comes to marja taqleed, you naturally, common sense dictates that you go to the most learned one. The one who has just declared himself a mujtahid, a marja, you say, you know, we are recording this again, I have to be careful of what I say. Sometimes jokingly, inshallah you don't misunderstand me, I say that we sheikhs, we are like carpet. Persian rug, the older, the more expensive. Can you believe that? The older the rug is, the more expensive it is. It's become antique. Or they say like wine, the older, the more expensive. Let me give you a halal example of it. Vinegar. The older, the more expensive. You know why? Because in our job, doctors somehow are like this as well. Experience plays a big role. No matter how smart you are, if you, in your youth, you have had that much time to delve into the ayat and the rawayat. The older you are and the more chances and the more time you have spent naturally researching about Islam, the more you have discovered. That's why you to go to a mujtahid who has been a mujtahid marja for the last 50 years, 30 years, 20 years is safer than the one who just yesterday has declared or has known to become a marja. It's again a common sense. Am I making any sense? So please, brothers and sisters, make sure if we are practicing our religion just based on what my parents have told us or what I thought to right to do, and it's not according to the Risala Amaliyya of an expert, it's just like fixing your car in your backyard or giving your car to a butcher, as we say. You don't give your car to a butcher to demolish, to damage your car. You're going to end up down the hill and really kill yourself and all the passengers. You don't want to kill your soul. This is about, in a nutshell, about the wisdom behind ijtihad and why is it that we have to follow a mujtahid in a nutshell. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
without any technicality of it, I just try to really make it in a very plain language. Now, further to this, there is one more step to this, and that is along with the issue of ijtihad and having a marja'iyyah taqleed for our religious affairs, the next step is that the topic of wilayat al-faqih, authority of a jurist. The moment we speak about wilayat al-faqih, some people, Sheikh is getting political, now we don't want this. We are here just to practice our religion, we don't want to know about politics. Please bear with me for God's sake 10-15 minutes maximum and see whether I'm talking politics or I'm talking purely religion. Today I gave an example to the youth. I said that how often, and in the last 10 nights of Ramadan, I said it's recommended to ask for the quick reappearance of Imam Hujjah. Imam Zaman that comes, I have one question for you. Is he going only to lead the prayer and answer our religious questions? Do you think that Imam Zaman will be just doing the task of a marja'iyyah taqleed and doesn't get involved in the affairs of Iraq, Gaza, all occupation and all the Muslim affairs, or he does get involved in that? And if he does get involved in that, do you think the West perceive him as the head of the terrorists or a man of God? It's very obvious how they are going to treat him, how they are going to accuse him, what kind of attitude they are going to show towards him. Before Islam, in the ancient time, religion and what we call it today, politics, or put it this way, state and religion were identical. The head of the religion was the head of the state as well. And hence, even in the Jewish tradition, Prophet Dawood, Prophet Sulaiman, they are referred to as King David, King Solomon. Prophets were kings as well. King in the sense of the head of the state. Prophet Musa was a prophet of God, at the same time the head of his community. Head of the community means the head of the state. There is absolutely no doubt about it. So the common practice in the old days, according to the teaching of God, Ancient, Old Testament, New Testament, was theocracy. Theocracy means that the head of the state has to be the head of the religion. At the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Prophet of Islam was, of course, the prophet of the messenger of this religion, and he was the head of the state as well. Anyone has any issue with that? The Prophet, definitely, he was organizing the head of the army. And he had a legislation, he had military, running a state in that level of that time as well. What was the major issue that caused division in Islam after the demise of the Prophet? And we have two camps of Shia and Sunni. What was the reason behind it? Who would be the head of the state after the Prophet, wasn't it? So it was the issue of the Khilafat that caused that division, and we have different opinions on that. Otherwise, the second Khalifa, Umar ibn al-Khattab, historians have recorded it, Allama Amini rahmatullah has kept the situation, the incidences, that over 70 times he approached Ali ibn Abi Talib, Imam Ali gave him fatwa, helped him on religious issues, and he says that Lola Aliyun lahalaka Umar. So the issue was not that whether Ali is more learned or not, Ali be marja'iyyah taqleed or not. The issue was whether Ali has to be the head of the state or not to be the head of the state. That was the issue. So the understanding of Muslim was that the one after the Prophet has to carry on with the same mission that the Prophet had, in the sense of head, being the head of the state. Alright? As Shia, we have absolutely no doubt that the Imams of Ahlul Bayt and Muslim, if they had the opportunity, they were the only one who deserved to be the head of the religion and the head of the state as well. And hence Imam Hussein alayhi salam went and fought. Okay? Because he was against Yazid, the tyrant Yazid. Yazid did not deserve that position. Now the question is that after Imam Hassan Askari, and now during this major occultation, in a Muslim country, who is supposed to be the head of the state? just by election, anytime they can, Harry gets is voted, and with all the lobbies that we do and proxy and all the politics in it, anyone gets the vote becomes the head of the state. Or the one who knows more about this religion is the pious among all. He's supposed to be the head of the state, because this is a position that used to be to belong to the prophets, used to belong to the successors of the prophets. And now in the absence of the prophets and occultation of the successor of the prophet, the one who is closest to those characters has to get that position. In today's world, they tell us that Walayat al-Faqih is dictatorship. I tell them that you guys, you believe in Walayat al-Faqih more than us. And you believe in it in a much more dictatorship sense of it. You don't believe me? Say salawat to share it with you. Which democracy was for the Queen of England to be the Queen of the England? Was there any election? Or there was just a monarchy? And you know today, there are 53 countries in the world, Kenya being one of them, Tanzania being another one, Uganda being another one, South Africa, Australia, Canada, name it. 53 countries in the world today are under the Commonwealth. That means 53 countries in the world are under the feet of the Queen of England. The number one Wali Faqih in Australia, the same in Canada that I'm more familiar with, is not the Prime Minister of Australia, who is voted by election by two parties only and people have no third option. The number one person is the Governor General, who is appointed by the Queen. The previous Governor General that we have in Australia, he was a bishop. Bishop is like an Ayatollah, similar if you want to rank it in Christian ranking. So the situation in today's world is that the Queen of England appoints an Ayatollah for Australia, an Ayatollah for Canada, and then for the other affairs they let there will be election. But the head of this pyramid, the very top one, is appointed, is not elected. Is this dictatorship or is not a dictatorship? Whereas in the system of Walayat al-Faqih, number one, the Wali Faqih is a jurist who is the pious, adil, okay? He is the one who knows about Islam, is an expert in Islamic studies and Islam and jurisprudence, particularly the practical laws of Islam. And even he is elected. He did not inherit it. Ayatollah Khamenei did not inherit it from Ayatollah Khomeini, nor did he inherit it from any previous one, if unfortunately there wasn't any before. The way that it works is that in different provinces, for example in Iran, people, locals who knew their scholars, Ayatollahs, that they trusted them, they voted them, they make an assembly of experts, and this assembly of experts consists of all the Ayatollah, pious people, God-fearing people, irrespective of independent from any Western influence, they say, they put their heads together, Yadullah ma'al jama'ah, and they vote for the one who is the most qualified person for that position to be the head of the state. The only reason, and God is my witness, in the month of Ramadan, Ya Allah, bear witness, and I'm delivering it here without any prejudice, Wallahu al-Azim. The only reason the West stands against the concept of Walayat al-Faqih, because so far as Walayat al-Faqih is there, they cannot like turn Iran to another puppet like other countries. The only way that we can keep our independence and our dignity as Muslims against the West and the Western influence is that the head of a state is independent, is God-fearing, not Western-fearing. This is the... And because they have noticed that, they are targeting that. They are trying to spread misgiving in the minds of, put question in the mind of the youth and others that what is this concept of Wilayatul Faqih? Take Wilayatul Faqih out of Iran. Iran is no different than Iraq, than Afghanistan, than other countries that easily influenced by the West, isn't it? Alhamdulillah for this blessing that we have. We are really lucky living a time that Alhamdulillah, and nobody is talking about the perfect Islamic system, by the way, don't get me wrong. No one claiming in that. Relatively we are talking about, relatively, in today's world that there are all elements against Islam, Alhamdulillah that we have one example, and proudly we say as Shia we are proud to have introduced this system to the world. Brothers, sisters, prior to the revolution, I'm not speaking politics. This is religious study, purely related to my faith in Islam and belief in Islam. Quran says, "Inal hukm illa lillah." There is no ruling but from Allah. Quran says, "وَمَنْ لَمْ يَحْكُمْ بِمَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ فَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْكَافِرُونَ." Whoever does not rule the country based on the rule of God, they are the disbelievers, kafirin, fasiqin. Now, the one who is the head of the state, if he doesn't know about the Islamic rule, how is he going to rule it Islamically? You see that the constitution comes from America. The judicial system comes from England. And they put it together. It becomes the civil law, secular law, not an Islamic law. An Australian guy came to my office some years ago, very upset, and he said that, "What is this dictatorship in Iran?" I said, what happened? He said, "Why do you have to have an Islamic state?" I said, "Why not?" He said, "Let people vote." I said, "Guess what? They voted, man." I said, "Imagine in Australia, you have majority by the survey, 70% are Christians. Are they majority? Yes. It is because of the majority that they decided to have Saturday, Sunday as weekend and Christmas as public holiday. Why my right is violated? Why Christmas be public holiday? No, I don't want Christmas. I want Ashura be public holiday. You see? You say because majority. My friend, we are talking about a country that majority are Muslim. Don't you say majority rules? Aren't you talking about democracy? Democracy necessitated that the absolute majority of the population in Iran who are Muslims, and by the grace of God following the path of Ahlul Bayt, they voted, they said, "We want an Islamic Republic." Do you have any problem with that? Where is what side of it is dictatorship? Just because they are not practicing what you practice, how you want them to run the country, then it's dictatorship? That's very unfair. تلك إذن قسمة ضيزة. Don't have this kind of attitude. Alhamdulillah, as Shia today, you really can keep your head up. That Alhamdulillah, we have a country in the world, a Shia country in the world, that can say no to the West. Yes, they are paying the price of it. They are paying the price of it. But at the same time, they have kept their dignity as Muslims. There is no virtue in that to have lavish life, but be the puppet of the West. The West and the White House has to decide for us, and the American embassy has to decide for us how to run the country. That's how Iran was in the past. And this is the issue that we have with our Muslim countries today. Today, if we didn't have these puppets as the head of the Arab countries, so-called Muslim states, so-called Muslim countries, what is Israel to exist? Rahmatullah alayhi Imam Khomeini was saying that if every Muslim spits, Israel is flooded. That's how easy it will be. 33-day war, many of you remember in 2006. Hezbollah stood against them. Which army Hezbollah had? A militia defending the country. And the other side is the well-equipped Israel. They could not stand against this militia of Hezbollah because they were united. The same, if we were united, definitely West, Israel, none of these would exist. Wallah, we are suffering because of ourselves. Because it was the style of Fir'aun to create division among us. To create division. And even when we have a good example, a role model, a political system, cast doubt in its legitimacy. Today I have this question for you, and this last word of mine inshallah. One last question. In your honest opinion, Imam Zaman Ajjalallahu Farajahu Sharif, is he more pleased with the government system of Iran, that the head of the state is a marja'iyyah taqleed, or he's more pleased with the, I don't know, with system that is in Pakistan, for example, that is in other Arabic countries? It's a common sense, it's very obvious. Alright, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, as the followers of Ahlul Bayt, we believe and we stand behind our maraja, hafadhahumullah, with respect to all of them. And Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen, that we live in a century at the time that we are experiencing to that limited level the practice of Wilayat al-Faqih. Something that our ancestors for many years didn't have that opportunity. And inshallah we pray wholeheartedly that this will be delivered to the global Islamic state of Imam Zaman Ajjalallah Ta'ala Farajahu Sharif with salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. I have not spoken yet about the first martyr among the martyrs of Karbala, among the youth of the martyrs of Karbala. Today, tonight, allow me to take you to Karbala. You know, in Ziyarat Ashura, when we say As-salamu ala al-Husayn, and then say wa ala Ali ibn al-Husayn. Ali ibn al-Husayn doesn't mean Imam Zainul Abidin, huh? It means, most likely, it means Ali Akbar. أول قتيل من نسل خير سليم. The first martyr from the family tree of the Prophet in Karbala. Allahu Akbar. Imam Hussein alayhi salam, because he loved his son so much that some of our scholars, they say that if Ali Akbar survived Karbala, he would be the next Imam. That is the status of Ali Akbar. Ali Akbar is the one that Imam Hussein alayhi salam says ashbahu an-nas bi rasulillah. He resembled the Prophet the most. Khalqan wa khulqan wa mantiqan. When he speaks, his accent exactly as if the Prophet is talking. His character as if it's a Prophet. Walking the style of the Prophet. And therefore Imam Hussein alayhi salam says that Ahlul Bayt have said, Sayyidah Zainab says that every time I miss my grandfather the Prophet, I look at Ali Akbar. How much he reminds me of the Holy Prophet. And look at this proof, this hujjah, this evidence that God is sending to those enemies. If they can see it among the enemies, there were some who had seen the Prophet. Couldn't they see that this young man, how much he resembles the messenger of God? Are you fighting the Prophet? Are you fighting the progeny of the Prophet? Not only, Ya Rasulallah, they fought your grandson, Ali Akbar, but because of all the grudges they had against Imam Hussein, they had against Ali ibn Abi Talib. Even after they killed Ali Akbar, historian had mentioned that فَقَطَّعُوهُ إِرْبًا إِرْبًا. They severed the limbs of Ali Akbar so much so that when his father Imam Hussein comes to carry the body of the son back to the tents, he cannot carry Ali Akbar because all the limbs is cut. أَلَا لَعْنَةُ اللَّهُ على القوم الظالمين وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. أما يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء. 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 أما يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء بجاه محمد وآل محمد صلوات.